Welcome to the Best in Heritage 2024. My name is Gabriela da Rocha. I'm a Brazilian Portuguese museologist dedicated to the application of digital tools and technologies such as 3D printing and 3D scanning for the documentation and dissemination of cultural heritage. And today I have the privilege of speaking with Pepijn Borgwat from the new Dutch Waterline project at the Gele Loods in the Netherlands. Hello, Pepijn.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too. Thank you so much for taking the time to share more about the new Dutch Waterline project. Also, congratulations to you and your team on the achievements with the project, especially for winning the Heritage in Motion Award last year, right?
Yes, yes.
That's amazing. We're going to talk about that. So could you please briefly introduce yourself and share a bit more about your career path and your role on the project?
Thank you. My name is Pepijn Borgwat. I'm the co-founder of Synergique, a company we founded 13 years ago. And we focus on museum design, exhibition design. And what we do in our company is concept development, spatial design, graphic design, and we have a big focus on animation and interaction. So we are always looking for ways to let the visitor engage with the subject and the collection.
Amazing. So let's start then. Could you please start off by introducing us to the new Dutch Waterline project? Also, I would love to hear some insights into the backstory behind it.
Yeah, so the new Dutch Waterline project started with an old arms barracks in a fortified town of Naarden in the Netherlands. And the organization Monumentenbezit owns and preserves a lot of monuments in the Netherlands. And they decided to turn it over and make a visitor experience out of this building. And they also researched the original paint color of the old building by taking samples. So they went really far to recreate the building, how it looked like back in the 19th century. And they approached us to design the exhibition, to design the visitor center, and also to make the animation that serves as a introduction to the new Dutch Waterline.
That's very impressive. And it looks like a huge transformation of the space, but also taking back the history, right? So last year, you and your team was distinguished with the Heritage in Motion Award. And I would love to hear your opinion on what specific aspect of the project impressed the jury. Like what qualities or innovations do you believe made the strongest impression?
Well, what the film does well, in my opinion, is telling the viewers step by step what the waterline entails, basically. So why it was needed, how it worked, and if it would have worked, because that's what you will see in the animation. It never got put into full effect during the war. We use original drawings. There were many, many schematics and drawings of the sites, but also of the separate buildings. And we decided to make it exciting and fun. We added additional drawings and additional animations. Our goal was to never make it childish and especially for kids, because that's what animations sometimes tend to do. So we kept it really serious, basically, but in a fun way. We animated old photos, and we were looking for nice transitions to tell the story and to keep viewers engaged. And I think the jury noticed that as well. And apart from that, we worked with a really good scriptwriter and a composer for the background music, which really was the icing on the cake, basically, when it was finished.
Amazing achievements. About this animation, would you walk us through the development process of the animation? I'm curious to learn about the motivations and the decisions made to enhance the public understanding of the Dutch Waterline by creating this animation. So could you share more and go deeper in this process? Because it was a lot of fun, but also with a lot of, education process also. Could you take us to this animation process?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, so we are designers and animators, but we don't know all the details about every project we do, of course, because we're not historians. And then our projects range from basically the Ice Age till club culture. So fortunately, our client, Monumentenbezit, who owns the Gele Loods, Gele Loods actually translates to yellow barracks, they had a lot of expertise on the subject of the fortified cities and of the new Dutch waterline, and even more on this specific city, Naarden, where these yellow barracks were placed. With the client, Jeroen van der Werf, he helped us a lot. He wrote a book about the city and about the waterline project, and he gave us all the information we needed, basically. So in close collaboration with them, we went to the information that we wanted to tell in the film. Mm-hmm. And we asked a copywriter, Rinske Wels, to write a script. She read his book, she interviewed him on the subject, and together with her, we worked back and forth to form the story, basically. So there were some areas we really wanted in there because we had such a nice collection as drawings and schematics that we wanted to use. And she is really good in capturing all this information and bringing it down to a story that we can tell like within 5 to 7 minutes, which was the aim. And with the script in our hand, we started to draw storyboards. Our animator, Tim de Groot, did that part, which we discussed with the client. So we take all these little steps that we always discuss with the client and have their okay before we move on, because animation is quite an intensive process and it's really hard sometimes to go back a step. So if, for example, if we started animating and they have something they want to change in the script, then, and if that part is already animated, then that takes up a lot of time. So we need to be quite strict in that and have all these phases. So once the storyboard was okay, we did a first draft of the animation. Once that was greenlit, then we started the animation itself. And during the animation process, we contacted Matthijs Koster, the composer and sound designer. And during the process, he was sending us some examples, some routes he could take for the music. And once we found a way that we really liked, we continued on the animation, and then in the end he composed the music and did the sound design for the film.
Looks like a beautiful co-creation process was involved, yeah. Right? Let's talk about the synergy between conceptual and spatial design elements that you adopt. How do you perceive its impact to enhance the visitor experience in this exhibition? And most important, when other cultural institutions adopt interactive and playful approach like this, what a specific aspect can be it a practice or can be it a methodology? What a specific aspects do you believe it's most crucial?
Apart from the animation, we did the entire exhibition. So I would like to step back a little bit from the animation and start there, because as the Gele Loods is also the visitor center of Naarden, we knew that a large diversity of people would actually be visiting. So we couldn't trust on the knowledge of the visitors, because they would come from all over and they would start as a blank, and then we would throw this new Dutch waterline in their face, which is a really abstract subject. So we really needed to take a step back as well and started explain, okay, where are you? And you're in Naarden, which is a fortified town. We was part of this really big infrastructural project. So we, like with the animation in the exhibition space, we went back to that phase, and we started at the drawing table. So the entire exhibition space looks like a big architectural drawing table, basically with some facets. And we had this big blue racks on the wall with more drawings, and everything is like, it looks like it's stacked on top of each other and just thrown out there, basically. So we really wanted to show as much visual information as we could. So a lot of drawings, the schematics, the photos that we had. And then we thought, okay, how are we going to make people more engaged and let people actually experience the visitor center? So we added 3 interactive installations for the explorers, basically, and visitors who wanted to learn more about the subject, so who want to delve deeper. One of those interactive installations was actually an architectural drawing table with an embedded screen inside that could have visitors scroll through photos and drawings. And then the third one was a full-fledged interactive game that we thought out and we developed together with Orb Amsterdam. And in this game, you were an officer and you had this inundation area, so an area that could be flooded. And you had to decide where and when and at what times you would flood the area if your town became invaded, basically. So you had to evacuate animals and people, you had to burn down forts if needed, and you had to decide where and when you would flood the area. So that's quite a challenging game, but it's really fun if you get the hang of it. So we looked at all these target audiences and gave each of them something to do, to read, to explore, or to play. And that's what we always try to do within our exhibitions, is have multiple layers of information, multiple layers of text, so people can learn something from each other. So that's always what we try to achieve. And then at the end of the visitor center, they can sit back and watch this 7-minute animation, which explores the entire new Dutch waterline.
So it's for everybody in all ages.
And basically, it's for, yeah. So we always say that everybody is not an audience, because you need to pick your audience. But with the visitor center, families come and elderly. So we did decide a couple of key audiences that we made this for, but it's a pretty wide range, and we gave each of them like one specific thing to do. So they could all enjoy like, I don't know, 20, 30 minutes in this visitor center. Yeah.
Great. So you, as a creative producer, you have an insight into the industry trends, right?
Yeah.
And yeah. Are there any particular approaches or technologies you first seen emerging as a game changer in the next decade that you could share with us?
In the next decade? That's a long time.
Oh, not that long. Time passed fast.
Yeah, but okay. So I thought about this, and so like if you would have asked this question 7 years ago, everybody would say, we have to make an app. And if you would ask this question 4 years ago, everybody would say, you have to do VR. And now people will probably say, oh, you have to do AI. You have to do something with AI. And what I think about those subjects and how it evolves, it always goes different than you think. So I think myself, 5 years ago, I thought, okay, every exhibition and museum would have some sort of VR exhibition now, or at least AR, or maybe AR is better than VR, or it would be like embedded in everything, and it's not. But still, billions of people are using AR on a daily basis without even realizing they're using AR. I mean, in Snapchat, in Instagram, in Google Maps, in Google Translate, where you can like overlay a different language on a live sign in the area. That's all augmented reality. But if you ask someone, have you used augmented reality? Most people would say, no, I've never used that, because they think about zombies walking through the living room, which they can shoot. It's becoming a commodity, and it's becoming another tool in the toolbox, basically, for us to use in an exhibition. With the biggest difference is that Google and Meta are billion-dollar companies, and most museums are not. So we have to really be clever and be smart. And if we want to use it, we really have to use it like in the right way and as intuitive as possible, so people don't even think about the technology they're using. They're just enjoying the collection or enjoying the story of the museum. And that's I think the same is happening with AI, because sure, in 10 years, everything will be AI, from the process, from the creation process until like what you're doing in an exhibition space. But I hope that people don't realize it's AI, but it's just another technology that enhances your experience and enhances your visit to a museum. So our toolbox is getting bigger and bigger. So what we can use to create exhibitions, and we will see new types of exhibitions over time, like what happens with like better projections and OLED screens. But the same way that museums 5 years ago needed to have an app, and I think 50% of those apps is now obsolete or not working or not updated anymore, the same will happen with AR or AI. You can like make an exhibition right now, but it would get outdated so quickly if you just make it about a technology. So basically forget about a technology, start with the collection, start with the story, and then find the technology that you need to tell that story. We can bring like photos to life and make a personalized audio tour or whatever, but only if the story needs that. and sometimes an offline hands-on game is way more efficient than another touchscreen. We love interaction, but we love to hide it as well.
Thank you. It's so refreshing to hear what you just said. And I just want to say congratulations to you and your team and on the achievements with the new Dutch Waterline projects at the Gele Loods Museum. Thank you, Pepijn, so much for sharing your insights and your perspectives during this interview. And I wish you a great weekend and bye-bye.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.